7. That's Psalm 46, 1 through 7, and it reads, God is our refuge and strength, a very pleasant help in trouble. Therefore will not be fear. Though the earth is removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof, Selah. There is a river, the strength thereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God should help her, and that right early. The heathen raged, the kingdom were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. May the Lord add a special blessing upon the reading of his holy word. Amen.
My brothers and sisters, friends and loved ones, where we are this morning, zooming in, we want to say welcome. Let us pray. Our gracious Father and our God, we come before you this morning on another Sabbath morning. We come to give you thanks and praise for your goodness and your mercies towards each and every one of us. Lord, as we come this morning to give you thanks, words cannot suffice to begin to say how grateful we are to you for your goodness and your mercies towards us. Lord, if there were never a time that we need you, it's now. And we give you thanks for allowing us to be alive at this time. We ask your blessings upon our brothers and sisters, wherever they are this morning around the world. We ask you that you would be with those who are going through difficult times, sickness and whatever. Lord, we ask you that you would look down on them in mercy, touch them with your healing power. Lord, we pray for our holy brothers and sisters at this time. Lord, we ask you that you would keep them in the hollow of your hand, give them strength and courage to go through this time. Lord, we ask you that you would be with us this day. Give each one of us the blessing that we stand in need of this day. We pray for the Sabbath school. We pray not only for our Sabbath school, but Sabbath schools around the world. Be with each and every one of us this day and give us all that blessing that we stand in need of. And we pray that when you should come or call, may each and every one of us have a place in your eternal kingdom. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Brother and Sister Blitz. At this time, we will make the necessary transition to our various different Sabbath schools, units, so to speak. And so right now, we'll just have that breakout to a very different various Sabbath school. And I just pray that God mercies and his direction will be with us as we study his holy word. Thank you.
Okay, good morning, everyone. We are just reminding everybody that if you have the latest Zoom, you are able to join a room. Just open break rooms, and you can join the room that you want to go in.
Hey, Barry, had me. I never remember to upgrade.
Right. I'm not the host. The host will add you to your rooms.
For thank you. To
have add me also to my room. Dean.
Good morning. I'm hoping that everyone has been assigned or assigned themselves. I don't know if anybody needs a couple of minutes more to do that.
Okay, Barry, I'm not assigned to my classes yet.
All right, I'm not the host. The host is taking care of those things. So in a short, just give us a second, because there's only one person having the responsibility to do all of that. So, and we just want to reiterate, people, if you have not yet done so, update your Zoom, and it allows you to join your own class. If you have not, if you can't do that, uninstall and reinstall Zoom, and it will allow you to, when the option is open, you can join whichever class you are able to. So thank you for the future. Please do that during the week. Our host is working now to get those persons in.
Okay, Sister Rosemary, could you let me know when you would wish for me to start based on the assignment? I don't know how long it takes for them to be assigned.
You can start now. Persons just type in the chat as they need to be assisted by the host for today's meeting. So you can start the lesson now.
Get to your class, you can start. Thank you.
This morning, for those of us who are in the main room, good morning, and hope that you've had a good week. We are looking at lesson number 10 this week. You will be here with me. If you haven't gone to your classes yet, we are looking at lesson number 10, Education in Arts and Sciences. The memory text is from Psalms 19 and 1. It says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork." This is from Psalm 19 and 1. When we look at education and arts and science, you always wonder, what's arts and science? I had a good look at it to see what it is. And essentially, the art is essentially creation using skill and imagination that brings some sense of pleasure, whether it's a poem or whether it's a sculpture or whether it's some other process. That is the loose definition. So it involves some kind of skill, imagination, to create a product that we find pleasure in. Science, on the other hand, is essentially, certainly modern science, is the promulgation of a thought process as to a hypothesis pertaining to a particular item, subject, or thing, or process that we would then, through dint of observation and other tests, try to determine if that was, if the theory or hypothesis that we put forth, if it is valid, and if it is not, then it is rejected, and another, based on what is being observed, is arrived at. And then, of course, it is subject to review, put out there for others to look at to see if it makes some sense in terms of what we arrived at based on our observations. That being said, we raise a couple of questions, because it says here, education includes what has been called the arts and science, but when we learn to teach arts and science from a biblical perspective, it says, the question is, what does that imply? And it says, in learning to see God, in learning to see how God views his creation as organic and purpose-filled, there are a couple of things that we need to do. In light of that, I've actually subheaded this education in arts and science as finding God in and through the arts and sciences. And so one of the things I looked at was essentially that one year of technology created. If you were to look on the Sunday, there are a couple of texts that comes up in this, and they're notably Romans 1, 18 through 21, Psalms 19, 1 through 6, and Nehemiah 9 and 6. One of the things that, I'm not going to go through all of it, but one of the things we find in Romans 1, 18 and 21, verse 20 in particular, says, "For since the creation of the world is invisible, attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." The question is, excuse what? Why would there be an excuse, and what is being used as an excuse? And it was the reason that one of the things that's being used is the fact that persons are saying that, well, they don't know there's no God, or that the things that we see around us are the natural products of evolution, or they just happened, you know. If you look also in Psalm 19:1-6, you see that says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork, day unto day, utter with speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. And then it says, in verse 4, the line has gone through all the earth, and the words to the end of the world, talking about the creation. And then he has set a tabernacle for the sun, and which is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoices like a strong man to run his race. Its rising is from one end of heaven and circuit to the other end. There's nothing hidden from its heat. And in Nehemiah 9:6, it says, you alone are the Lord. You have made heaven, the heaven of heavens, with all their hosts, the earth, and everything in them, the seas and all that is in them, and preserve them all. The hosts of heaven worship you. The question I raise after all of this is, can you distinctly see God in the creation to the point where there is no dispute? Anybody can answer if they would wish. Is there any dispute? And they say them all strange, but there is. But, you know, like I say, I don't know if there's any dispute. For some persons, it may be, because they try to lie that there is no God. They try to put that out there, that everything that we see naturally is a product of evolution over so many long years, so forth and so on. We know when we look out there that there are some things that you just can't see an evolutionary process. In fact, I would start off by saying, look at our brain. What's evolutionary about that? That is so profound that to this day, it is being used as a basis on which persons model and build other things to try and compute, to try and see if they can arrive at some form of artificial intelligence or machine learning that can be used to understand and process information. And so, you know, you have to wonder, in fact, with whether they're right or wrong in that approach, that there is no God. You have to question what it is they're looking at, why they feel that there is no God, because you can't see, when you look at everything around you, how that conclusion is arrived at. But, you know, they obviously have their thing for it. But in looking at this lesson, there are a couple of things I want to touch on.
Can I?
Sure, go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah. Morning, everyone. I'm very excited about this lesson. Unfortunately, I won't be able to be in for the entire time. But it takes us back to creation. 2 points I want to make. One is, if you are not coming from a perspective of God, even when coming from a perspective of God, it's difficult to answer all the questions and to understand everything, because we are human and we are degenerated human. So we will not be able to understand and explain everything. God created us in the first place as perfect human beings who would evolve into understanding more and more and more of his power, his might, through studying science and arts. That's what, when man was told to take dominion of the earth, that was what it meant, so that they would be able to understand the science, the laws behind what he did, how things happened, how they coexist, how they change, and also to understand science and arts in a way that it can bring pleasure to us, so that we are in dominion. With man having degenerated, or ability to understand is even so much more diminished. But with the diminished understanding and appreciation that we have, when we look if you look from the perspective of the fact that there is an intelligent design, or even if you don't, it's obvious that there is an intelligent design. When you see how science and arts eludes us to explain everything. When you look, for example, when you look on art, if you want to take art into consideration, you just look on the birds, look on the colors, look on the fashion statements that they make, look on the coordination of the different hues of greens, and look on the sound. That's art. Look on the music, look on the sound of the different birds, the sound of the wind through the trees, look on the grass and the sunlight as opposed to the moonlight. All of that is art. And the more you pay attention to it, is the more you understand how vast and limitless it is, and how much appreciation you can get from it. And then it leads you to a point like David to say, oh my God, what a wonderful, wonderful creator. And then when you study the sciences and you start looking on the laws, you realize that there must have been a force that put all of this in place, that even until now we can't explain everything. So, however, Satan's plan is for the earth to take dominion of man instead of man taking dominion of the earth. And therefore we feel that we are subject to, and we need to be able to explain everything that is there. And when we can't, we create, we make explanations to satisfy the fact that we are in charge.
Excuse me, Patrice, please, station identification. Please give me a moment. We accidentally named unit 2 after your unit, which should have stayed in the main room. So we're gonna assign all the persons for unit 2 to Kenley and Patrice. That unit is made. Please do not leave if you are on unit 3. Well, Kenley Danning and Sister Patrice, please stay in the main room. The others, Rodwell and Rosemary, we can assign them to unit 3, the breakout room that's called unit 3. We apologize for the inconvenience. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Yes, so the closer you look at it and the more in tune you are with God, you can see God through it. But if you're determined to see man in it, if you're determined not to see God, you can see something else.
Thank you, Amanda. Hey, you've essentially summed up everything. I could close up shop.
Kenley, morning everyone. I have a question piggybacking of something Patrice said. What if God had, when he created us, said God formed man of the dust of the ground? And what is the next statement? And breathe into his nostril the breath of life. What if he didn't put the breath into us? Would science have been able to do that? So there has to be a higher being.
You know, you touch on this, and it raises an interesting point. And I added as a little notation here, because we talked about it to some degree last week in the afternoon Sabbath school. And it is essentially, have you ever been in search of something? What is the first thing you do when you go in search of something? First thing you do is make a visual pattern in your mind as to what this thing looks like. So when you see it, you recognize it. That's the first thing you do. If you're searching for something, you already know what it is you're looking for. But what happens if you're looking for something, but you don't have a clear-cut idea as to what you're looking for? Or you look for it, but you're distracted by something else. What happens at that point in time? You come up with all kinds of stuff that may not necessarily be what it is that you initially had in mind, but you think that it is, right? Sometimes, again, you're distracted. You may be looking for a particular item and you're distracted and you find yourself spending more time on something else that has nothing to do with what you initially started looking for. And so I say that to say essentially that if we look for something, like Sister Patrice says, inevitably we will find that. If we look for God, we will find it. If we decide that there is no God, we will find enough to make us believe that there may not necessarily be a God. But if you have an open mind, eventually you will come across the fact that there is nothing here by chance. that it has to be some higher power, some bigger objective than just we are existing, and it just happened by happenstance. You know, I'll put it in this fashion. But every destination, there has to be a beginning point. And the beginning point essentially, to a great degree, determines how you get to your destination. And in fact, even if you reach your destination, think about it for a split second. If you will go into London, you start out in Nassau, you go through a particular set of circumstances to get to London, where you're familiar with how the airport is set up, ticket process, so forth and so on, that takes you through. Do the same process from Miami. Processes may be similar, but where we go and how we arrive at them are different. And if you were to start out in Miami, trying to operate as if you were in Nassau, I would almost guarantee you would not get to London. And it's the same thing that when we talk about this, the process that is used to determine whether God exists or not. Rather, in fact, what we're looking at is really his handiwork, or whether it just happened by chance. And what you will find is, to a great degree, you start with the wrong premise, then at some point you will find that you've lost your way, that you are not necessarily where you should be. I mean, it's happened to all of us at some point. We mistake a corner when we're traveling, or the second corner when it's actually the third corner. We roll through it looking for what we're supposed to be going to, only to find, wait a minute, hey, what I'm supposed to be looking at, it isn't around here. And so just by way of commentary on it. But when we talk about the Lord alone, like I said, we look at Psalms, we look at Nehemiah, we see all of these things that says that for those of us who believe in God, that he is here. The problem that we find with a lot of the scientists, if I can use that terminology, is they have essentially divorced God from the whole process that they're looking at. And they're saying, if I can't measure it, then it doesn't exist. But we know that that is a fallacy for a great reason. Because, take for instance, we have the school of thought that says to be productive, you should be able to measure your productivity. But how many things you see out there in nature that you find have an end product, but you can't measure how they arrive at the end product? You do, but you see the final product, but you don't know how it was arrived at. It doesn't say that because you can't measure it, it isn't there. I'll give you and when we talk about hypothesis, there's something you should put out. You know, there's this great talk now about the search for planet 9 out in the vast reaches of the solar system. Some people theorize it's there. Some says no, but look at the competing theories, all looking for planet 9. Some saying it's caused by potentially the disruption in a solar system that reports to show that there is a body out there that may be planet 9. It's caused by it. Others again saying it may be some black hole. Others again saying it's a disruption that's being caused by so many small changes over a long period of time by bodies out in the Oort cloud, which exists as a cloud of debris around the solar system. And the list goes on and on. But at the end of the day, like I say, these are competing interests that don't necessarily have anything that shows outside of the fact that, hey, there is a higher power out there somewhere. Whether you want to call in God, whether you want to acknowledge that there is intelligent design or not, it is a fact that it is there. And so one of the things in teaching the arts and the science, we have to realize that all things have a beginning. All creative processes have a beginning. And so the beginning is the creator and what materials were used, or in God's case, the fact that he created the material. And now that brings me to the point in terms of we try to essentially make art and make science as two separate pieces. And you may feel that there's no relationship between them. And this is where you realize that the Godhead is essentially the thought process is above and beyond anything that we can think of. When we look around us and we see the science in things and we see the art. And when we create things, we do the same thing. You use the laws to determine how something should be. And then we use our creative product, our process to create a product that utilizes those laws to enhance our well-being, be it by making us feel good. I mean, case in point, look at something as simple as your phone or your computer that you're now looking at. You'd be surprised at the amount of science that's involved in that, but it was the arts using the creative process that produced that. Because we could have as much science as we want in there, but if it was not a creative process to produce something that we can actually enjoy and use, it would do us no good. So I don't know if anybody has anything they would wish to add, any comments they would want to make, any statements on it. Okay. We talk about God, acknowledge the fact that he's the creator, the fact that we see all the stuff around us. Question, when you look at works, creation, any of those things, what do they tell you about the creator? Whether it's mankind, whether it's God, any thoughts? What do we get from it in terms of when we look at this, what does it say about the being who would have done the creation? You get any idea?
Teacher?
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
I find it incredulous that there are folk who, and my apologies, good morning to all of the participants in the lesson study this morning. I find it incredulous that there are persons who would actually sit back and say there is no God. Before I go into the points I really wanted to make on that, I found it funny that there was a gentleman who was making a very negative statement towards the local church in the press. And he said, there's no God, we are so silly and stupid. And then he, towards the end, he talked about what is immoral and justice and all of these things. And I'm wondering, I said, I wish I had an opportunity to ask him, but where did you get that from? You know? But anyways, God, one of the things that strikes me, and I'm sure any number of other persons with respect to who God is, first and foremost is, he is a God that loves beauty. Secondly, he's a God of diversity. Now, just about everybody, I suspect, love apples. Some may love oranges more than apples, but just look at apples. It's a store way out west that you find stuff that you normally wouldn't sign. Every now and then, I go down here to just see what's going on. I can hardly afford to go in there. But I saw these very small apples that looked like gigantic jujus. And that's about as big as they were going to be growing. But you have, in the red apples, you have a whole range in size and color, etc. And you go to look at bananas. There was a fellow around by where I live that was growing purple bananas. All right? There's an apple that grows in one of the regions that is, they call it a black apple. It's a very dark, dark purple. When we look at the diversity in, you go in almost in any area of flora and fauna, all right? And you see the diversity. Look at fish, snapper that Damien's love. They have all kinds of snapper. I was in Costa Rica and we were at a restaurant, incidentally called Bahamar, and the guy brought out a snapper that was about 2.5 feet long, called a Corvina. I'd never seen a snapper that big. And I said, man, I can't eat that. And so we shared it up around. We told him what to do with it, how to grip. Now, the fact of the matter is that how could anyone just say there is no God? Look at orchids. There's some classic elements that you would find with an orchid. But look at the diversity. I just say I cannot find how anyone could look at birds, the beauty, the intricacies of some of the birds that they have, and say that it happened by happenstance. The beauty and the diversity. Even if you look at, I'll end by this, even if you look at the human race, all of the diversity of the races was reposed in the seed of Abraham. Abraham carried the seed for all of them. And a lot of persons argue, but climate did this? No, no, no. We have missionaries who went to Africa and stayed for more than 50 years, and they were still white. So the fact of the matter is that God is a diverse, even in any area of human existence, and you see it. Look at the colors of the water in the Bahamas. You could stand on the rocks in Crooked Island and see about 4 different shades of turquoise and green.
Yeah, you're gonna have to sum it up for me, sir.
That's it.
Oh, okay, no problem. Yeah, thank you so much for the contribution, which you're absolutely right. But the question I raise is, when you look at all of this stuff, what does it say about our creator? What does it say about the creator? You know, I look at some of the works that's created. And you can always tell when you look at a particular product, whether the person was a master carpenter or craftsman, or whether this was a journeyman. When you look at something that's been put together. Same thing when it comes to painting, whether this was an apprentice or whether this was a master painter, same thing when it comes to sculpture. In fact, the strange thing is, based on the work, you sometimes can even look into the mind of the person, because you can determine to a great degree whether it's someone who's careful, whether they are painstaking in what they do, and you look at the small details. So in a lot of cases, I mean, case in point, look at the paintings of Van Gogh. You know, Van Gogh may have been what we in the Bahamas would call somewhat crazy or psychotic to some degree. And then you look at his paintings. You can see the turbulence in them, just in the brush strokes, various strokes. But mind you, they are fascinating. But you can see the fact that his mind was unsettled just based on the paintings. And when you look at Picasso with his cubism, you can see certain elements in there again that speak to what his mindset was. And so it's the same thing with the creator. When you look at the fact that, like Brother McKinney says, so much diversity, so much beauty around, the fact that he loves diversity, loves beauty. When you look at the order that exists, you can see that he's a God of order. And so we can find a lot of the elements. When we look at Monday, it talks about the beauty of holiness. And Psalm 96 and 9 reads, "Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth." Question to the class. What is holy? What would you describe holy as being? Any thought processes? Any takers? Okay, I see I have no takers. Anyway, if you look at it, beauty is a holiness is essentially purity. When you say holy, we're talking about set apart and holy. Thing I found interesting is when you talk about beauty, how sometimes we look for beauty in something that is ostentatious sometimes, or sometimes some of the most beautiful things or some of the most simple things. And you find sometimes again beauty in character. How many times we've looked at persons and seen that from a physical standpoint, they may not be eye-pleasing. I shall use that terminology. But from a character, personality standpoint, beautiful. In fact, you would inevitably usually find that the persons who are not endowed with physical beauty, a lot of them seem to have the beautiful personalities and characters. And so the Lord has balanced them out to a great degree. It talks about the fact that beauty can be a two-edged sword. How is that? Any thoughts? Can beauty be a double-edged sword? Any thoughts? Okay, nobody wants to comment, even though I see we have 29 participants. Well, how many of us have seen?
Okay, so I did raise my hand. So we'll
I didn't see it.
Yeah, if you check the raise hand section, then we could figure that out. But the first part with about the character is about holiness. Holiness is the characteristic of God. That is holiness. I doubt it can be defined beyond that because it's infinite. It cannot be contained, but it is all that is God and more than what our brain can comprehend. Still, the part that I want to make mention about is when you mention people with physical beauty. Beauty, we have to understand that beauty is not what Hollywood describes it to be or portray it to be. Because I have baffled with this for some time. And I don't find, in the general sense, I wouldn't find a frog to be beautiful. However, I'm certain that another frog, would find that frog charming, right? So in that sense, I think we have to be very careful with how we define beauty and physical beauty, because physical beauty, it's not what is portrayed on the media. It is not, because again, a typical thing to this is African Americans, because of our facial features, it is said that Europeans are perceived to be much more beautiful than us. Why? Because of how their nose is structured, because of how their lips are structured. But you still find in the psychology of things, Europeans are still trying to be dark like Africans. And then you have Africans are trying to be light skinned like European. So beauty, you have to be very careful how you perceive and portray what is beauty, because it is much more than that and beyond that. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're absolutely right. In fact, you would find that various cultures have different ideas as to what is considered beautiful. In essence, beauty is that thing that brings a sense of pleasure when you look at it. It uplifts you, makes you feel good. It is something that you desire. When you look at it, it brings a sense of pleasure. And so you will find that it's subjective. In fact, to a great degree, physical beauty is conditioned or learned. A lot of things that we look at, there are some things that in fact are universal, you know, in terms of the two-thirds rule, so forth and so on. But there are some things that are culturally learned. So what may be beautiful in one culture may not necessarily be the same in another. And so,
Brother Kenley.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
You know, we talk about all these things. We say we know and what have you about knowledge and all of that. But everything requires faith. Even to believe what the atheists believe or the agnostic, everything requires faith. For us to believe what we believe, it requires faith. And that comes as a gift from God as well. You know, so, I mean, scientists can't explain the origin of anything. And the Bible says that knowledge will increase. And what as scientists we are doing is discovering what God has created, but we can't even determine how it originated or where it came from. So it takes a measure, it takes faith for everything, you know? And I choose to be on the side of faith that believes that God exists, that he says what he says. Because if it isn't so, then one thing, but if it is, and I don't believe it, then I'm in trouble. And I want to be on the right side.
You raise an interesting point, sir, in that you talk about knowledge increasing. And the thought popped in my mind as you were talking about it. Knowledge is increasing, yes. No question about that. But is wisdom increasing? Thought process. Would you say that we've gotten any wiser? Or is it just that we become more knowledgeable? Because they're not necessarily the same thing. And I would, let me see what the commentary would be from the class on it, whether they think that we've gotten wiser. Any thoughts? Go ahead, Brother Colin. I see your mic is still open, and then I'll take Brother Troy.
I'm just pondering the thought and trying to come up. you can know something. Like Solomon was considered the wisest man, but he did not apply what he learned about stuff. So you could be wise, but in your application of it, you could be stupid.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, Jesus is wisdom. The Bible refers to wisdom as a person. Jesus is where we get our wisdom from. You know, if you have, it's just like being having a car that has 450 horsepower in it. You sitting in the car, you got it parked, and if you never turn that engine on, or even if you turn the engine on, but if you don't put your foot to the pedal, you will never know what that can really do. You only heard about what it could do. But you have to apply what you get to your life in order to make it real. But you may still be wise in your knowledge, but foolish in your application, like Solomon was. Then he finally came around.
So, well said, Brother Troy.
Yes, there's a clear distinction between knowledge and wisdom. One is the son and one is the father. Because we have to understand, one book said that and before the age of 40, it is seldom that someone has wisdom. It is really after the age of 40 that they really acquire wisdom. What they gain before that is knowledge. And even if you look at it, these great inventions these days, in terms of scientific breakthrough, you find that these guys have knowledge, but not necessarily wisdom, because what do they do with these technology that they develop? They cease to destroy and to disseminate and cause problem between nations. You cannot be wise. You cannot have wisdom. Yet still, what you have created with that knowledge, wisdom would not allow you to make it as a weapon to destroy people. No. Wisdom is used for the betterment of everyone. And regarding Solomon was the wisest man at one point, right? But he couldn't be the wisest man. Wisdom was never there when he started to use the knowledge that he gained to praise other gods and stuff. No, wisdom left him at that time. He has the knowledge. He was wise at one point, but then he was misled. He was led astray. So again, I think wisdom is the father, and knowledge is the son. You know, it's a process. Thanks.
A parent tells a child don't put your finger in that socket or you'll get shock, or don't touch that or you'll get burnt. The child does not listen, and they put their hand on the hot iron. Every time they see an iron, whether it's hot or not, you think they can touch it? Now, is that knowledge or wisdom? And that's a child. Yeah. So we can learn wisdom from early.
Mr. Teacher, I think that is knowledge as well.
That's knowledge. That's still not wisdom. Knowledge
as well. He knows after that you don't go sticking no hairpin hairpin inside no socket. I had a nephew did that and he was out like a light with his eyes wide open for a minute or two. He couldn't do anything. I'm sure he never did that again. My take on wisdom is this. I believe that true wisdom comes from God. You see? Because you could be 50 years old beyond the point of 40, as Troy indicated, but you're still a JA. It doesn't, if you're not connected to God, you put yourself in a position to be outside of the realm of wisdom. Okay? And I think that we have to see wisdom as a connectivity to Christ. And I agree with what Brother Troy mentioned, which is an important point. It is not that I think that after a while, because remember now, all of us live in sinful flesh. After a while, I believe Solomon got arrogant and he forgot about wisdom, such as was applied to the two women with respect to the child that one was claiming because hers died in the night and she wanted to have a child anyway. That kind of wisdom. But over time, Solomon got arrogant and he just went off on the other direction, knowledge. He just, started doing stuff without, he lost his connectivity with God. Because when you start becoming a philanderer, taking on more than one wife, you're disconnecting from God. So outside of God is very difficult. I could be wrong.
No, I don't think you're wrong. We should leave it at that. Brother Troy, make it for me. I see your hand is up. Oh, that was from an old posting.
Yes, that was from an old posting.
Okay, cool. No problem. Sister Griffin.
Yes, I'm in the wrong class, but nevertheless, it's the same word. Yes.
Welcome. Thank you. We might be able to recruit you.
I was listening to Brother Colin's point and Brother Troy's point in the definition of wisdom. All right, so what came to my mind when you talk about, the boy who put his hand in the socket and haven't gotten that experience, does he have wisdom now? So I'm thinking, since wisdom is defined as you now have a quality of experience, you now have an understanding and you now have knowledge, I'm thinking that boy who had that experience with the socket, he now has wisdom. So he will now tell somebody else that, you know what? Because of what I experience, because of what I know, don't put your hand there. Don't put a pen there. And I am lost for words sometimes when I read Proverbs and Solomon and I look at his life in the book of Kings. And my daughter and I, we were reading and I was like, how on earth he can make such mistakes? He was the wisest man. He had this understanding. And when I look at what he admonished young people, listen to your mommy, listen to your daddy, follow the instructions. He could only say that in Proverbs when he get to the point that
hindsight.
From my experience,
from my knowledge, make that statement.
You better listen. So sometimes wisdom comes from our own experience. We've been burnt. We understand certain things so we could speak from that platform. So that's what I was thinking. Thank you.
You're absolutely right.
I want to right behind that.
Make it brief for me because yeah. I see we up at 10:55.
Yeah, I still contend that knowledge comes from God. What about the guy? Let's forget the socket and the shock. What about the guy who goes and drinks half a bottle of gin and wakes up with a terrible hangover, vomited all over himself? As soon as that hangover passes, a couple of days later, he's doing the same thing. and he continues to do the same thing. He has the knowledge, the fact that he knows that he will have a hangover. Is he still wise? No, I contend that he's not wise, and it's not wisdom is not necessarily learning the effect of something. Okay, some people become wise as a result. The wise man would go to the word and discover the Lord said, "Wine is a marker, strong drink is raging, and whoever's deceived thereby." All right, so he says to himself, you know something, I ain't messing with this no more. That's wisdom.
Brother Trice, your honor, make it brief for me, please, and then I move.
Yeah, I'm going to make it very brief. Wisdom, I think, is what the ladies, the sister said before, and much more. Again, what you're speaking of is cause and effect. Cause and effect is not wisdom. I mean, if you touch a thing and it burn you, a child will pull away and a baby would pull away his hand. That baby is not wise. But what's wisdom? Wisdom is, hey, I touch this thing and it burned me. There's heat. Now, what could I do with that heat? I could use that heat to generate warmth inside a house. I could use that heat to make a meal. I could use that heat to straighten a hair. That is wisdom, the application of that knowledge to make things better for people, not a cause and effect reaction. Because as tiny as a baby is, if you slap that baby and then the baby will pull away. You understand? If you slap the baby will cry. It is not wise, the baby is wise. No, they're just simply reacting. Anyone come and if they smack you, you'll step away. You'll say, okay, this person, it's dangerous. That doesn't make you wise. What makes you wise is to realize that, hey, perhaps I could figure out what is wrong with this person. Why this person keeps smacking me? You might then start looking the psychology of things to find out what is really going on in that brain and how can I help other people as a result of this who perhaps have the same kind of mentality or behavior to be better off. Thank you.
Mr. Teacher, very quickly.
Hold one second for me, please.
Teacher, time is up.
I just need the host to determine how we're going to do the lesson study process because I didn't see anything pop up. I don't know if it did.
Okay, let me share quickly. Since we're back in the class, we know that we're asking the individual classes to take their audio, do their class study by let them put their hands up in the breakout room. Or you could ask them to just indicate. But I know one or two classes having that problem. So we'll try to do a poll quickly while the interlude is played because it's important that we get that information. Because we know one or two other classes didn't report. So we'll do a poll quickly.
Yep. Just 1.2, what I did with unit two, because we have everybody listed in the class, We just ask persons in that group to indicate whether they're studying or not. So we don't have to waste time during the period. So we would have gone to unit two with the listing of the names and the persons would have noted that they're studied right there. So that's
the same thing is true for unit one and four.
Thank you.
Okay, so I need all those persons who would have been a part of unit three to indicate.
In the group.
You can do it in the group or you can do it via chat.
Yes.
So those persons are unit three, please.
So I studied Kenley.
Okay. Gotcha. I see we are exactly at 11. So you can do it by chat for me, please, and for unit three. Exactly at 11. And thank you all so much for participating. Come back this afternoon at 3:15 and we will continue and conclude. Thank you all very much.
Same. He is worthy, and he's worthy to be praised. this morning as if you were in the sanctuary. Wherever you are, join us in praise. Lift your hands as we sing to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's raise our voices.
This is the Russell I studied. I'm from Dr. Carter.
Let's just do one more time. Come
before his presence.
We'll now have our announcements by the church clerk.
Good morning, church, and happy Sabbath. These are your announcements for today. We are in unprecedented times, and many of our members are experiencing extreme difficulty. As we continue to trust God for firm faith, let us continue to put him to the test and watch him deliver. Our part is to be faithful stewards, not only in giving of tithes and offering, but in all that he has entrusted us with, our time, talent, treasure, and temple. Though we may be virtual, you can still offer your time and talent to assist in one of our many meetings by reading the scripture, giving the welcome, singing a song, or by encouraging others to return faithfully of their increase. There is still much to be done, and God needs our hands. During this weekend, December 4th to 5th, the South Bahamas Conference Youth Ministries Department is presenting the Festival of Youth. This event began last night and continued this morning at 9 a.m. At 4 o'clock this afternoon will be the final session. Youths, you don't want to miss this. Check the church's group for the flyer and the link to this spectacular event. The treasurer is requesting that all members making direct deposits to the church's Royal Bank account to also follow up with an email to jptreasurer@sbsadventist.org.bs, giving a breakdown allocation of funds. We are truly grateful for those who can. For those who are not able to use this method of return, by all means, do continue dropping your tithe envelopes at the South Bahamas Conference office. We thank you for your benevolence. Please note that we have resumed Sabbath school units. The units will be constituted as follows. Unit 1 and 4, that's John Carter and Roger Lewis combined. Unit 2, Rodwell Dean and Rosemary Sands. Unit 3, Kenley Darling and Patrice Gordon. Youth, Shakira Romo Joseph, and children, Nikita Dean. When the break rooms are opened, you will have the opportunity to choose your class. To take advantage of this feature, please ensure that you have the latest Zoom update. This would definitely make it easier for our media team. If there are any challenges, the media team will be on hand to assist. Teachers will be taking the study register in the unit breakout rooms. You are admonished to study the daily lessons and come prepared to share and uplift each other. The Sabbath school lesson review will continue this afternoon at 3:15. All are invited. Please use the Divine Hour Zoom link. The regular church board meeting will be held next Sunday, December 13th. That's next Sunday. Board members are asked to prepare for this meeting. Our Adventist youth will join the South Bahamas Conference Festival of Youth at 4 p.m. today. Please continue to have focused prayer for our sick and at-home members and reach out with an occasional call. Let them feel the personal touch that JP is known for. Our Sunday morning prayer service will begin at 6 in the morning. The link will be forwarded in the church's group. Our prayer and praise service continues this coming Wednesday at 7:15 p.m. It will be conducted by the Treasury Department. All are invited to attend this midweek service. Our Pathfinders will be doing cookie making tomorrow with Sister Denise Woodside. Parents, please assist your children in having the ingredients measured and prepped for this fun activity. The Zoom link will be posted. And there will be no Pathfinders tomorrow. Please continue to join us for our Sabbath Dawn Praise this Friday at 7 p.m. You may send your requested song to one of the hosts. We invite you, our members, to visit, follow, comment, like, and share our Facebook page, Johnson Park Seventh-day Adventist Church. Visit and leave your comments, prayer requests, encouragements and suggestions for improvement on our website, www.johnsonparksdachurch.com. Subscribe to our YouTube page, Johnson Park Media. On all these platforms are a wealth of resources for you, our members. Past sermons, links, recipes, to name a few. Please invite your family and friends to do the same. Your support is valuable as it encourages those who spend countless hours developing them. Your feedback is welcomed to ensure these platforms are never static. Help us get the message out through our social media network. We don't have any birthdays listed this week. However, happy birthday to all who celebrated a birthday this week. Sun sets today at 5:19. Have a wonderfully blessed Sabbath and stay safe.
Face to face with Christ my Savior. Face to face, what will it be?
Happy Sabbath, everyone. How does that make you feel? I don't think that makes you feel happy because I don't sound happy. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Johnson Park members, visitors, friends, family, wannabe members, I'm just so happy to have you here on this beautiful Sabbath morning. You know, I like the cool weather, but I like the cool weather because when it's cool and it's a little bit more than I can bear, I can get something comfortable that makes me feel cozy and just right. And it's the same thing. Sometimes we want to go to church and we like church, but church is not the same without our friends and family and well-wishers worshiping with us. Our brothers and sisters in church is like my shawl. That just makes it cozy and comfortable. I know I'm in a good place and I know I'm here for a good reason, but my friends make all the difference. It's beautiful, it's comfortable, it's cozy. It just makes you feel just right. And that's how each of you make me feel this morning. I know we are Johnson Park, the church known for the personal touch. And just about this time, we'd be so excited to hear the Aiken at the piano and the drums going and everything. And we would be running around to get a hug from everyone. And I know that you're missing those hugs. What I want you to do for me this morning is to type in the chat someone you missed hugging. For me, I know I'm going to have to list a number of people. Yeah? So I want you now to just put yourself in that mindset. Think of the people you'd be scrambling across the way to get a hug, to get a kiss, to squeeze, and to shuttle back to your seat before the music ends. It is just like my shawl. It brings such comfort and warmth and coziness just to think about each other. And so we know God is here with us, and we're so happy to be a part of this worship session, but we're also happy that each other is here. You see, Zoom has allowed Johnson Park to not just be located in Nassau, Bahamas, but right now Johnson Park is in Europe, Johnson Park is in South Africa, Johnson Park is in the United States, Johnson Park is all over the Caribbean. And how do I know that? Because I have seen you all in the chat. So reach out and touch somebody. If you're a visitor or you're a member, you now have the brand of being someone with a personal touch. So reach out in the chat, write a name, and we will all know that it's a warm, fuzzy hug, the personal touch from Johnson Park. Outside of being together with each other, Jesus has invited us to be blessed and to take this blessing to others after we would have left here. So I invite you to put away your concerns, your fears, your anxiety, your stress. Even if you are, even if you're just wearing your nightgown, just feel like a princess, feel like a prince. Know you're in the presence of God and enjoy the worship session. God bless you. And don't forget to touch by writing a name or some names. God bless you. Be still and know that I am God.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are happy to be in your presence today. We thank you for the warmth of the sun, and even for the coolness of the breeze that we feel. We have come today to give you honor and to give you praise. We thank you, Lord, that your presence continues to be with us. I pray that you bless each of us, and may we not be disappointed having been in your presence. I pray in a special way for the membership of our church, and even for those who have come from week after week, who have joined us on the Zoom program. I pray, Lord, that the messages that we have shared, the influences that we have shared on this program, will be of such that others will be encouraged to want to have a closer walk with you. So we ask you that you'll bless us. And today we ask you too, Lord, that you will accept our worship. Accept us because we know that we have not all done the things that we ought to do. We have not been obedient in many cases. We have not been truthful. But you are a loving God, and you will forgive. So, Father, we fall at your feet today, asking for your forgiveness. In a special way, I ask you that you'll be with your speaker today. As he speaks, give him power so that his words might reach our hearts, and we might cry out, I yield to your power. Bless us to that end. And once again, Lord, accept our worship. Forgive us of our sins, we pray. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. I am Carly Evies with the prayer and scripture. All heads bowed and all eyes closed, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us to another month. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us to another Sabbath day. Dear Lord, I thank you for allowing us to all meet during Zoom, dear Lord. Thank you for everything that you've done for us. I ask that everyone understand the scripture, dear Lord. And I ask you to please bless your word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. The scripture reading is taken from Psalms 119, verse 130. The entrance of your words give light. It gives understanding to the simple.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. My name is Carissa Alves and I have the children's story. Jesus was a great teacher, the best ever. Crowds listened to him. Jesus told them to be merciful, good, and kind. Others may hate and hurt them, but God would care for them. Jesus taught many things. He said, God's people light up the world the way a candle lights a house. What a difference a candle makes in a dark room. The people Jesus spoke to believe in revenge. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But Jesus taught kindness, forgiveness, and love, even towards enemies. In Jesus' day, Some people pretended to be very holy. When they gave money to beggars, they had a man blow a trumpet so everyone would look. Do your giving in secret, and God will reward you, Jesus said. Jesus taught the same about prayer. Some people prayed on busy street corners so everyone could see and hear them. They didn't care about God. They cared about what others thought of them. Jesus called them hypocrites, false actors. Jesus often used nature to explain his teaching. For example, he pointed to the birds. Your heavenly Father feeds them, he said. Don't worry, God will also feed you. Even rich King Solomon was not as well dressed as the lilies. Jesus continued, if God clothes the grass of the field, will he not also clothe you? Jesus was teaching people to trust God who provides for all our needs. If you judge your brother, it's like trying to take a speck of dust from his eye when you have a great big log of wood in your own eye. Jesus said, perhaps people chuckled, but they had to think of his meaning. Jesus said, people should ask God for help. Do earthly fathers give a lump of stone when hungry children ask for bread? No, they give good things. God also gives good things to those who ask. Jesus, the great teacher, warned about false teachers. They dress like sheep, Jesus said, but inside they are wolves. He said false teachers would be known by their lives they lived. In a story he told, Jesus showed that people who obey God's word are like a man who built his house on a rock. A terrible storm arose. When it ended, the house stood firm. But a foolish man built his house on sand. When the storm lashed against it, it fell apart because of its weak foundation. Jesus said that people who do not obey God's word are like that man. The crowds were amazed at Jesus' words. They had never heard such things before. Now they knew it was not enough to hear God's word. They must also obey it each day.
We'll now have our welcome by Brother Aaron Jones.
Thank you very much, Brother Sanders. At this time, we will have our offertory. Bright and early, a high school teacher once instructed his students to put away all of their books and take out a blank sheet of paper. This is something most of us were familiar with back in our days of school. It was time for a surprise quiz. And the students all grumbled and complained as we usually would, but eventually they all did as instructed. As you would imagine, the students that did not have routine study habits did not do so well on this quiz. As they usually do. However, those students that studied regularly, regardless of whether there was a pre-announced assignment or not, had much better results on this surprise test. As we do our walks in our Christian lives, we should remember to always be prepared for those unexpected tests in faith that will come from time to time. So although at this time, financial resources for some of us may be limited, we can still be prepared to do the work of the Lord and continue to be faithful stewards in giving our time and talents to aid in the building of His kingdom. However, for those of us that are able to give, please continue to do so diligently and faithfully, and you can contact instructions on how to transfer your tithes, offering, and other contributions as needed. Let's bow for prayer. Dear kind and loving Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for allowing us to continue to weather the storm of life as it comes our way. Help us to be always prepared for your second coming, and for any events of life that do come to us and during the time we are left on earth. Bless those that have to give and those that have not financially, but help our time and talents for the benefit of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
While playing tennis with a friend, Ricardo came across the tithing subject. His friend, who attended an evangelical church, told how things were done in his church.
Well, in my church, all money collected is retained and administrated locally.
Oh, really?
Yes. Isn't that how you do it in your church?
No, we actually use the storehouse system.
Storehouse system? What do you mean?
Well, resembling the biblical storehouse principle, the Adventist Church brings some of the funds collected by each local church to a common bucket and then distributes them equitably. In that way, all local, regional, and global financial necessities are supplied.
Oh, wow. Sounds interesting.
Yeah. Then, all the tithes are used exclusively to support authorized missionaries, while offerings are mainly used to support the local church, other regional and global evangelistic projects and ministries. And if we identify ourselves on the envelope, we even receive receipts from what is given.
So there's basically an auditing system?
Exactly. And we may have access to all financial information of the church.
But do you trust this system?
I trust God. I know the system is managed by fallible human beings trying to do their best, like me. But no incidental human failure will affect my practice, because I actually give it to God as an act of worship. And He is in full control of His own business, you know?
Ricardo was right. With the representative system adopted by the Adventist Church, no individual or interest group is the owner or controls all the funds. Local church and regional representatives elect regional and world leaders for limited terms, and they are regularly audited on how they use the church's resources. Besides that, all pastors and leaders are paid on the basis of a common salary scale. 21 million members worldwide contribute to the same pot with tithes and promise or regular systematic offerings. And the church is now present in 213 out of the 235 countries and areas recognized by the United Nations. They do that because united, they are stronger and are able to do more and go farther. As you return your tithe and give your promise, pray for those who haven't received the message of salvation, so that through this act of worship, they can be reached. May we put our desires last and God first.
Good morning again, everybody. Before the welcome, there is a brief, important matter that I'd like to bring to your attention. We are coming to the end of the year, and you know, because of the COVID situation, we have not been able to have church as we would normally do. And so we have not gotten a chance to look at the officers for the year 2021. However, don't panic, because in the provision of the policies of the church, I think that can be easily taken care of. And so this morning, I am bringing to you a recommendation for you to look at. And if you agree with that method, then that is how we will proceed. It is customary for nominating committee to elect officers for 2 years. We have not been doing that. So it is even now becoming necessary for us to do something like that. Those officers who were elected for the year 2020, which is this year, the board, upon looking at the situation and discussing the issue, and myself, we would like to recommend that we appoint, or we ask the current church officers to continue in their position for the year 2021. We are aware that there are some persons who have resigned or moved away, but when this would have been agreed upon, the church board can make recommendation to the church at large to fill these offices. Let me say that again. We are recommending that the current church officers continue for 2021. Those offices that have become vacant because of people declining, or rather resigning, or have moved away, the church board will make recommendations to the church to refill these offices. I'd also like to say that if there are members in the church and you feel that in 2021, you can make a notable contribution to the work of the church, please speak to myself and the elders, and we will also, if we agree, recommend that you join the workforce of the church for the year 2021. Your support for this venture is important. And so if you agree upon the recommendation, I would like you to type yes on your devices. And if you don't agree, type no. If you agree, yes. If you don't, type no. And later on, we will tabulate the no's and the yeses, so that we can move on from here. In another matter, on the 16th of this month, I'll be journeying to Crooked Island for about 2 weeks. I won't be back until the end of the month. There are some serious issues that have occurred, not on Crooked Island, but in Acklands. And those issues need my urgent attention. I had asked before that you pray for the church, because what is happening is that some of our leaders who are not understanding how the church functions, they have joined forces with the local Church of God Church in order to empower them to do service both for our church and their church in the community. So you see, it's a matter that I need to go to address. I want to thank you for paying attention to your church. This week, Brother Dr. Carter and Elder Hepburn and myself have been going around trying to make contact with as many of you as is possible. We're going to continue that in the near future. When Sister Flowers make contact with you, if you are willing for us to come and see you at this time, please indicate. I know it's a funny time because, you know, COVID is out there, but I promise you that when we come to see you, we will keep our distances, so we will not be a part of the problem rather than a part of the solution. So I look forward to seeing you as much as is possible. As we continue our worship today, I'm happy that you have joined us, all of you. I'm not looking at the list of persons who are on right now, but thanks for joining us and thanks for choosing to worship with Johnson Park today. There are so many other Zoom programs out there that you could have gone to, but you have chosen to be with us. We really, really appreciate it, and we hope that you'll be blessed by the decision that you have made. Our speaker for today is a long-standing friend of mine. He goes by the name of Selburn Frey. Many, many years ago, we lived together in the same area. We worked in the same conference. And I think even though I might have been a little earlier than he, we started having children about the same time. Started sounded like we had a continued string of children, but it's a term we use. I only have two. And at the time, I only knew he had one. I don't know what has happened over the years. Maybe he could tell me if he has gotten to five or whatever the number is. At that time, Pastor Frey loved fast cars. And if you think you were on, if you were on the streets while he was passing, you would fully understand what I'm talking about. I think he told me that he had a Mitsubishi Evolution. That was a car of speed in our time. I don't know what the cars are now. You know, I thank God for his angels, his guardian angels, because some of us do work, some of us do allow them to, or we make them work overtime for us. And I think Pastor Frey was one of those. Ooh, the guardian angel, boy, they work overtime. I remember at one time, I'm just telling you how I knew the guy, right? I remember at one time, I had two lovely German shepherd dogs, you know. I had them from, they were puppies, nice dogs. And one day they went across to my neighbor's property and killed and ate two of their prize Nubian goats. Now, this is a special kind of goat. And it cost me a pretty penny to compensate the man for his goats. And I was going to put down the dogs. And Pastor Frey came to their rescue and he took them and kept them, those two German shepherd dogs. I don't know if you remember that. I was happy that he did that because I really love those dogs. We have parted company for many years, but I follow him on Facebook. And at one time he served as Dean of Men for the Northern Caribbean University. Since then he migrated to England, where he continued his ministry. And then I heard that he moved to Canada and he currently serves as a district pastor in the Ontario Conference. I have known him to be a powerful preacher of the word, and through his ministry, many have been won to the Lord. When he was asked for a bio, he just said that he's just a little country preacher trying to make it to heaven while encouraging others. I would like to welcome Pastor Selburn Frey and his wife, Sancia, and their daughter, Denelia, to Johnson Park Church. And I pray that as you speak to us, the message you give from God will encourage us to make it to the kingdom. God bless you as you speak. Before he speaks, though, we'll be listening to a song of meditation. Continue to keep him and his family in prayer, and may he give us a word from the Lord. The song of meditation.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Our scripture reading this morning is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. And I'll read in your hearing. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he did fly. And one cried to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then I said, "Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then flew one of the seraphims to me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, "Lo, this has touched your lips, and your iniquity is taken away, and your sin is purged." Verse 8, "Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?' Then said I, 'Here I am, send me.'" God has already blessed his word. Thank you.
Amen and amen. Good morning and happy Sabbath, Johnson Park, Seventh Day Adventist Church over there in the Bahamas. It is a joy and a privilege of mine to share with you today in your worship experience. I am so happy for the opportunity this morning to speak on God's behalf, because I know this morning that if any of you have an opportunity to speak on behalf of your prime minister or your president, you would not give that opportunity up for nothing. You would have dressed nicely, you would have appeared nicely, and you would have. And so today, I'm grateful that I have the opportunity to speak to the King of Kings, speak to you on his behalf. I must let you know also this morning that this should have been my Sabbath off, because I preached my last sermon last week, Sabbath, at my former district of churches. Next week, Sabbath, I will be introduced and presented in a new district. So this should have been my transitional week. But when the call came from my friend and his wife, Daniel and Patrice, I could not say no to them. And so I've given up my Sabbath rest to speak to you this morning. Thank you so much, my pastor and my friend. We are coming from way back, from 1986, when I entered the campus of the then West Indies College, now NCU. We lived in the same dormitory, and from those days, we have had this kind of relationship. And I want to thank God for your ministry. I want to thank God for your love for his people and your love for the word of God. Thank you, Patrice, for extending the invitation on behalf of your husband and allowing me this morning to lift up the trumpet and loud let it ring, telling men and women that Jesus Christ is coming again. And so this morning, thank you, Pastor, for your kind words. Yes, I'm just a little old country preacher, struggling and trying to make it into heaven. But I'm not doing it alone. I'm encouraging others along the way, so that together we can make it into the kingdom of God, where our struggles will be over and all our joys will come to an end. Our sorrows will come to an end and joy will be with us forever. Pastor, let me tell you this. You may not know, but guess what? One of those German shepherds that I rescued from death, one of them is still alive in Jamaica. I'll let you know that. One passed away because of old age, but one is still alive. And I want you to know that that was the best gift anyone could have given to me, those two dogs. I love them with all my heart. It pained my heart when I had to leave them and leave them in the hand of capable family members. And thank God that they're still alive. You come to motor vehicle, my angels right now, I think they're working harder than when I was in Jamaica. They are working much harder now than when I'm in Jamaica, because one of my churches is an hour and 45 minutes from home, and you got to understand that. And now the car I drove then in Jamaica, you thought that was quick. No, you need to see this one. I'm getting 480 torque to the pedal. That's a lot of power under that thing. I can easily run up to 250 without any struggle at all. But God's angels are still watching, and they are still working, and I remain in the speed limit. Don't judge me now. I remain in the speed limit. Praise God and hallelujah, and thank you, Jesus. So let's get into the word of God this morning. And Pastor, because you were my senior, I always do what my seniors would do. I always allow my seniors to be one ahead of me. So when you had two children, my wife and I, we had one. We were waiting for you to get to three so we could get to two. And so because you did not go any further than two, we stopped at one. So it's only one child, 18 years old, first coming to her first, the end of her first semester in university. I want to thank God for our children and pray over them. So if you this morning will join me in prayer as I enter God's word. Father in heaven, we thank you. We bless you. We glorify your name, because your name is above all names. And so this morning, here is your son standing in the need of prayer. Oh God, just allow me to be a nail on which you will hang this morning, that I will not be seen, but Jesus Christ alone will be seen high and lifted up. So Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart, oh God, please
I ask this morning that whatever shall be said and done will be acceptable in your name. And I'll be very careful at the end of this deliberation today to ascribe all praise and honors to your name, because your name is to be praised. Thank you, and lead us into the word now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our text under consideration this morning is Isaiah chapter 6. And I'll begin reading at verse 1. The Bible says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Let me read that again for somebody. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Let me stop right there, and let's stay there for the next few moments this morning. Let's enter into his presence this morning. I have been watching, and I have been listening, and I have been a part of many worship services since March across the globe. And I want to let you know this morning that worship and praise is still a part of our duty to our Creator. Worship and praise is still a part of our duty to our Creator. And so if you need a title for the sermon this morning, only four words: I saw the Lord. I saw the Lord. You need to understand today, brothers and sisters, that he laid you down to sleep last night. He did not have to wake you up this morning, but somebody online can help me said, yes, he did. He did not have to shield you from that accident that was coming your way yesterday. But praise God and thank you, Jesus. Yes, he did. He did not have to give you food, but he did. I wish somebody in line right now would join me and shout the words that I'm saying. He did. He did it. Yes, he did it. I don't know what your it is, but he did. Yeah, you need to understand, brothers and sisters, that all of us online this morning listening to me right now, we all have some kind of it in our lives. I don't know what your it is, but I know what my it is, because we all have different kind of it. But you need to understand that the struggles that you're going through right now is not it. The struggles that you're passing through right now is not it, because the same God who took you through it when you were 15, he will carry you through it when you're 51. The same God who brought you over when you're 18, he will bring you over when you're 81. Can I talk to somebody here right now? You need to understand that the God I serve, if he did it for you when you're 25, he will do it for you when you're 55. Hey, somebody need to listen, walk with me this morning. If he did it for you when you were a teenager in your foolish state and your crazy self, if he did it then for you, you must be assured this morning that right now that you're mature, he will continue to do it. Somebody need to shout from your bedroom. Somebody need to shout from your living room. Thank you, Jesus, that you did it for me. When we worship God, he will transform our lives. For us to go through this stuff around us, we must go to church with a mind to worship. I remember this song we used to sing back then in the days when I was growing up as a little country boy down there in Hanover, Jamaica. This is a song we used to sing. I don't know how many of you know it. Every now and again I hear it being sung. It goes like this. We have come into his house. Gather in. Oh, somebody know what I'm talking about. Gather in his name to worship him. Worship him, Christ the Lord. But then the verse I love very well, it says, let's just forget about ourselves. I wish somebody know what I'm talking about this morning. Self must be crucified. Self must die. He said, let's just forget about ourselves. Concentrate on him. Who is this him you're talking about, preacher? Let's concentrate on him and worship him. Worship Christ the Lord. Somebody in line need to know that if they're going to make it, we must worship God in spirit and in truth. You see, Isaiah was a worshiper, because he realized that when you worship, victory will come. Hey, somebody need to know that whatever you're going through right now, if you want victory, you need to start worshiping God in truth and in holiness. Because many of us go to church to worship, but our worship is not accepted because we are not worshiping him sincerely. We come to worship and our mouths are closed. We come to worship and we are afraid to open up our mouth and thank God for what he has done and what he's doing in our life. So you come to church as professional worshipers. I'm going to get down to that. But we have too many professional worshipers in God's church today. Oh, we come to worship, but we sit at the same seat every Sabbath. We come to worship, but if somebody sits where we have been sitting since we started going to church, it's going to be a problem. Hey, when you walk into God's house, it doesn't matter where you are. It's an opportunity to worship God. Somebody need to know. Isaiah, that's good, our text. Isaiah said, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. You see, when Isaiah penned this passage of scripture, Isaiah was going through some tragedy in his life. Isaiah the prophet was going through a hard time because his close friend, the king of Judah, Uzziah, had just died. He was his personal friend. Some say that they had a personal relationship. They were close. He was a mentor to Isaiah. And you need to understand, brothers and sisters, that when Uzziah died, Isaiah started to grieve. He was grieving. He was going through a tragic time because his king is dead. And he is unable to get the grief from the tragedy from his mind. I know somebody online, as a matter of fact, I'm quite sure that all of us online today have gotten to the point where we have lost a loved one and we are grieving. If you ask me, I tell you this stuff. I remember it clearly, like yesterday on November 25th was 10 years exactly when I got the news on the call that my dad passed away. He was my close friend. He was my confidant. We had so many things in common. And when I got the news, I'm telling you that even on 10 years after, I am still grieving. I still feel the tragedy. I still feel that. I wonder if somebody online know what I'm talking about. But then I realized that David there sent us a word today. He said, preacher, you are grieving. Preacher, you're going through a tragic situation. You might be weeping now, but let me help you, preacher, as you grieve. Because Psalm 30 says, the weeping. I wish somebody online in the Bahamas, I wish somebody online internationally right now, that said, weeping may endure for a night, but hallelujah and thank you, Jesus. It said, joy is coming in the morning. Your night may be long, your weeping may be long, but I have good news for you, that joy is coming. This world did not give it to you. This world can't take it from you, because when you talk about Jesus, it brings joy to my heart. So Isaiah was gripped with loss, personal tragedy. He's dealing with something that make him not wanting to get out of bed. I wonder if you're walking with me. He doesn't want to put away the cover from his head. He is stuck under his cover all night, communicating with his pillow through tears. He was crying, and now the morning breaks up. He did not want to wake up. He just want to remain in bed. He doesn't even want to pull open the blinds and see the sun shining through his window that morning. He just want to be in bed because he has lost his friend. Ladies and gentlemen, he was mourning. He was mourning the loss of his friend, Uzziah. Isaiah remembered it, but he said, if I only, this is where the pastors didn't see them, if I only focus on the king's death
I will be in a mess for a long, long time. Isaiah is talking to the saints on light today, and he's saying, you see, there's a song we sing as Adventists, but most time we only sing the verse, the chorus of this of that song. But how many times have you spent time to look at the words of this song? Because you need to see the Lord in all his glory. The song goes like this. Oh soul, are you weary and troubled? I know that there are many weary and troubled folks online right now. Oh, there's light in the darkness, you see. But there's life for a look at the Savior. And that's why I have chosen the topic. I saw the Lord. There's life for a look at the Savior. And life more abundant and free. Then the chorus went on to say, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will go strangely dim in the light of his glory and praise. I wish somebody in line know what I'm talking about. That if you look to Jesus, your darkness will become light. If you look to Jesus, your problem will disappear. If you look to Jesus, your cancer will go. If you look to Jesus, your sickness will disappear. But when you keep your eyes on Jesus, he will carry you through. So turn your eyes upon Jesus. Isaiah could no longer stay in his house. Walk with the preacher today. Isaiah could no longer stay in his house. So he got up in his house, got dressed in his house. Then he walked through the door of his house, walked along the streets, and he saw people mourning. He saw them crying, but he realized that he could not only look at what was happening out there. So he left his house and he went to the house of the Lord. Hey, somebody to get that one. Let me say it again. He left his house and he went to the house of the Lord. And the Bible says that when he got to the house of the Lord, all his problems disappeared because he said, I saw the Lord. Let me talk to God's children online today. At our house, there is confusion, but in God's house, there is unity. Hallelujah. At our house, there is war, but in God's house, there is peace. At our house, you feel alone, but in God's house, you are never alone. At our house, there's no food, but in God's house, there is bread of life. At our house, there's weeping, but in God's house, there is joy. At our house, there is tragedy, grief, and death, but in God's house, we will see the Lord high and lifted up. Let's go back a little bit. I don't know your original church, but my original church back home in Jamaica, we could only read from the King James Version of the Bible. I don't know if anybody online know what I'm talking about. All other versions were fake, they would say. So we only could read from the King James Version of our Bible. But guess what? I just read earlier from the New International Version. Let me share with you what I read to you a while ago. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, read with me, I'm in the New International Version, I saw the Lord. But if you go to the good old King James Version, I love it. I love that version. Come here, Brother King James. Read that passage to me. He said, in the year that King Uzziah died, I also. You don't miss that one little word. It changes everything. That one little word changes it. I also saw the Lord. Ladies and gentlemen, you need to understand that when you come into the house of the Lord, you will see grief. You will see tragedy. When you come in the house of the Lord, you will see mourning. You will see turmoil. You will see loss. I say a thought, confusion. But after seeing all of these things, he said to us today, I also saw the Lord. All those things are negative and stress causing. But the good old King James said,
I did not spend my time looking at them, because I also saw the Lord. For us to make it through the struggles, it's only possible when we take our eyes off the things around us. Can I name a few of those things that we have that we need to stop looking at? We need to stop looking at those modest keepers in God's church. We need to stop looking at those backbiters in God's church. We need to stop looking at those backstabbers in God's church. We need to stop looking at those slanderers and gossipers and liars and false witnesses. When we move away from these things, you need to understand that you will see the Lord sitting on his throne. I want to let you know that when I was much younger, I used to do a lot of running. I was an athlete in high school and in college. I used to do a lot of running back then. But let me tell you something. This morning, I don't have the energy anymore to run those races. So I'm staying right here in Isaiah chapter 6 this morning. I'm not running all over. I'm staying right here in verse 1 this morning. Walk with me. I am still in verse 1. He said, if we are going to make it through what we're going through, when was the last time you stand in your house or in the house of God and just don't care about who's around you, don't care about what they want to say, just open up your mouth? Because when you remember of the goodness of God in your life, when you remember the good times you had with the Lord, when you should have been dead but God kept you, when was the last time that you don't worry about anybody but you stand to your feet, open up your mouth and say, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah, for what you have done for me. It's time for us to throw professionalism aside when we come into the house of the Lord. Because when we come to church, we are not in a courtroom. We are in his presence. We must lift holy hands. I don't know, many of you go to church, but you're dead. Pastor, I don't know your church. I've never been there. I know nothing about your church. But let me tell you something. If you understand David, David said in Psalm 150 and verse 6, he said, let everything that have breath. I don't know where you are this morning. I don't know what house or home you're in this morning. But the Bible said, when you have breath, you must use it to praise God. He said, let everything that have breath praise the Lord. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy of our praise. We praise man for inventions. We praise man for all the things around us. Well, their time is over. It's time to praise the Lord because he deserves our praise. I submit to you today, my brothers and sisters, that our churches are filled with fake folks. Folks forget how to praise God. Don't tell me how to praise God. I know that some of you are happy that worshiping is on Zoom and not in the building anymore, because Zoom, move you, they mute your mic on Zoom, and you're not in as many people are happy about that, because you don't get to disturb them. You don't get to disturb their professional worship session where they just come sit down and listen and drink and just drink and can't find the moment. But every now and again, I get a Jeremiah feeling inside of me. Can I talk to somebody in line right now? Every now and again, I get a Jeremiah feeling inside of me, because when Jeremiah said, oh God, I will never open my mouth and call your name again, but then God sent something down inside of him. He did not just go inside of him, but he got inside his bone. And when Jeremiah felt it, I wish somebody would feel that this morning. Jeremiah said, I feel like a fire shut up in your bone. When fire is in your bone, you can't keep silent. You're going to shout it from the mountaintop. You're going to shout it because of who he is. He is our God of everything. Every now and again, we need a Jeremiah experience. I don't know about you, but I love these two words, but God. Is there somebody in line right now who needs a but God experience? Oh, let me break it down. I'm using those two words, but God. Let me walk with you right now. There's somebody listening somewhere, maybe in the Bahamas, maybe in Africa, maybe in the United States, in the Caribbean. Somebody right now need a but God experience. You want to say, you can stand up to your feet right now and say, I was sick, but God healed me. I was lost, but God found me. I had no money, but God paid my bills. Are you still out there listening to me right now? I had no friends, but God comforted me. I had nothing, but God became my everything. I had lost hope, but God gave me hope. God is still there. God is still amazing. Somebody need to know that our God is an awesome God. Oh, yes, he is. He is still in control. Oh, God, I love this part of the text. You see, the text says, he saw, also saw the Lord. Let's stop right there for a moment. I went through that. He saw other things. He saw other people. He saw the mourning. He saw the tragedy in Judah because they lost their king. He was not the best king, but he was not even he's not the worst king either. He was in, he's just like me. I'm not the worst. Neither am I the best, but I'm still climbing. There's a song that we used to sing back home. I hardly hear it these days. It goes like this. I'm coming up on the rough side of the mountain. Lord, I'm doing my best to make it in. So I'm not the best, but he's still working on me. I'm not the greatest, but I'm not the worst. He still have his hands on me. You don't come too close to me. Don't touch me, because my paint is still wet. But thank you, Jesus. He did not throw the clay away. He is the potter, and I am the clay. When I'm broken, he'll pick the pieces up, and he'll put them back together again. Over and over, he makes me and mold me into his likeness. Oh God, he fashioned this clay, a vessel unworthy. Oh God, a vessel of honor. I am today. Oh, somebody right now in the Bahamas listening online right now, somebody says, thank God he didn't throw the clay away. We complain too much of God's children about our little challenges that we're going through. We complain too much about the little problems that face us every now and again. Because may I submit to you today that no one can make it to the top on the smooth side of the mountain. Preacher, fix that. No one has never made it to the top of the mountain when the side was smooth. Try it, and you come back and tell me if you make it up there. Because every time you go up, you're going to slide right back down. Every time you go up, you're going to slide back down. But hey, ladies and gentlemen, when you're on the rough side of the mountain, at least there's somewhere you can cut your toe. There's something to hold on to. There's, you may get some bruises while you're climbing up. You will get some cuts and some broken bones. But I hear Jesus saying to the today, that when you're on the rough side of the mountain, he said, thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Stay on the rough side of the mountain. And praise God, I promise you that you will make it in. But let's get back to the text. Let's get back to the verse. The Bible says, Isaiah said, he was sitting on a throne. Woo! I love that. Because Isaiah did not say that he was pacing back and forth. I remembered when my wife was in the Mandeville Hospital giving birth to our child. I remember that Sabbath afternoon. I remember it clearly. She was in the delivery room and I was in the hallway and I was walking back on foot. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Don't just sit there and go on like you don't know what I'm talking about. Your loved one is in surgery. Your loved one is in the delivery room. You behave as if you just sit there calmly and wait. Hey, I was pacing the floor back on foot because I did not know what was happening in that delivery room. So I could not keep silent. I did not even know what set child it was, because I prefer not to know. So I was pacing back and forth. All I asked God for was for a healthy child. Somebody needed to say amen. And I was pacing back and forth in the hospital hallway. And I was there. But here in the text, I said, did not say the Lord was walking back and forth when there were turmoil going on in Judah because King Uzziah had just died. There was no back and forth for the Lord. Isaiah said, I saw him sitting on a throne. Somebody need to understand what I mean. That simple means that he was not worried about anything. He was sitting comfortable. He was saying to us that I am in control. Oh God, somebody need to understand. No matter how bad your finances are, God is in control. No matter how bad your children are, God is still in control. No matter how bad your boss is, God is in control. Can I get some witness online right now? No matter how bad your health is, God is in control. No matter how the country is, God is in control. No matter how COVID is, God is still in control. Somebody needs to say hallelujah. He's sitting on his throne. Even when church folks are out of control, even when you yourself listening right now is out of control, God is in control. He's sitting on his throne. But that's not all. Walk with the text. Walk with the text. He said he was high and lifted up. Every now and again when I travel, and when the plane is getting ready for landing at the airport, I realize that when I look through the window, I like to fly looking through the window, even though I'm only seeing clouds up there when I'm up there, but I love a window seat when I'm traveling. And I've traveled some mighty long journeys. I have traveled 27 miles nonstop, just sitting down there. I walk up and every now and again, and I love a window seat because I like to look outside. And anytime that plane is hovering over the runway, when you look at those big lorries, those big trailers, I don't know why you call them in the Bahamas, those 18-wheelers and those 53-feet trailers, when you look at them down low, they look small like a little pebble. Somebody know what I'm talking about. They don't look as big and massive when you're next to them, when you're driving your little car and you're next to them. They look small like a pebble. Can somebody walk with the preacher right now? I wish somebody in line know where I'm going right now. You need to know that the God who is in control, he's sitting high, which means that your problems, no matter how big they are, they look like a little matzo seed to God. Hey, somebody need to know that whatever your problems are, God sees them as nothing because he is God. You know, at one point in my life, I used to pray and tell God, I still pray, don't get me wrong, I still pray, but I used to pray and tell God how big my problems are. My bills are high, my tuition was high in college. My mortgage is high. My car note is high. I used to tell God how big those things are. But, you know, one day God had to grab me by the shoulder. And he shook me. And then he shook me hard. And I'm telling you, while he was shaking me, he was saying, Frey, you need to remember this. Remember this. Don't you tell me how big your problems are. It is full time you change and reverse your prayer. It is time you tell your problem how big I am. Somebody need to get that right now. You don't need to tell God about your problem. You need to tell your problem how big your God is. Because the songwriter says he's big enough to rule this mighty universe, yet small enough to live within our heart. How big is our God? How vast this universe? But yet still God is still in control. Folks need to pass in front of Johnson Park when this is over. When COVID-19 is finished and we're back to church, folks need to be passing by the pavement in front of your church and wonder what is happening inside. People need to understand that when we get back to church, it should not be business as usual, because we need to let the world know who we are and whose we are. Because if you're a child of a king, you cannot keep silent. You cannot share it by yourself. When God takes a hold of you, you can't keep it. again, things have to change. From some of us were born in the Johnson Church, from that church started, you're still singing the same doxology song. And if you try change it, it's an uproar in the church. If you try change the order of service in the church, it's a problem. If you try to take anything, let me tell you something. You need to understand that when God takes a hold of you, normality goes out. Things that were normal will go through the window because God deserves our praise. And sometimes we got to put tradition aside. We got to put tradition away and allow God. Hey, listen to me. When the Spirit of God takes over you, things cannot be the same. Let's talk to somebody right now. Anytime Jesus shows up in your life, in your church, things must change. He turned up on the wedding in Cana of Galilee and water turned white. Can somebody say amen? He turned up on Lazarus' graveside and he that was dead came back to life. When Jesus shows up, things must change. Cannot be the same. Cannot be business as usual because you're not in control. Pastor Gordon is not in control. Your conference president is not in control. God is. When God is in control, we must submit our ways unto the Lord. We need to see who God is and who He is not. We have some things that we are working on. None of us have the right to point finger at anybody. None of us in God's church is holier than the other. Oh God, we are all striving for perfection. I once saw a bumper sticker that says, "Don't judge me because I don't sin the same way you sin." Woo! Woo! I was driving behind a car, let me say it again, and I saw a bumper sticker that caught my attention. It said, "Don't judge me because I don't sin the way you sin." Because you need to understand that we are all sinners. But thank God today, hallelujah, we're all saved by grace. I know today somebody in line is saying, "Pastor, all my life has been a member of God's church. All they do is tear me down. I try to do this and they pull me down. I try to say this and they pull me down. Even right now I'm online, but I'm still being pulled down." Let me share somebody. When they pull you down, shout hallelujah. "Hey, Pastor, what are you talking about? You mean when they're tearing me down and want to trample me?" Let me tell you something. A person can only pull you down because they're beneath you. Let me drink some water. Let me take a drink while that one settles. Let me say it again. I'm saying that a person can only pull you down because they're beneath you. Woo. Woo. Church, you need to understand that the God we serve is not beneath us. I am so happy today that the God we pray to, the God we give our praises to, is not beneath us. He's above us. And that's why I can say hallelujah, because the song says that if I get lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. It doesn't matter who you are, Christ is drawing you. It doesn't matter what you have done, Christ will draw you. No matter where you have been, Christ will draw you unto himself. Don't worry about people tearing you down. Don't worry about their ridicule you and ostracize you and criticize you. Jesus will never criticize you. When Jesus speaks about you, this is what he will say. "Yes, Selburn Fraser, sinner. Yes, Selburn Fraser, liar. Yes, Selburn Fraser, no good. Yes, he is. But, hallelujah, but my blood covers him. My blood covers him." I wish somebody in line right now would say, "Cover me, Jesus. Cover me, Jesus, under your blood. That when the blood sucking, can I use that word? When the blood sucking leech come after me, they can't suck my blood because they will take your blood. And when they take your blood, they come to kill me." Because somebody in line needs to know that no weapon formed against God, he got you back. Now, if you can confess it, if you can confess it, God will pardon it. If you can face it, God can fix it. If you know what I have been through and where I have been, because if you did, many of you maybe would not be online right now listening to me, but I thank God today that he still holds me in the palms of his hands. I'm looking at Christ. I saw the Lord high and lifted up, sitting on his throne. So if God is in control, then my living will not be in vain. I am not all that I want to be, but he's still working on me. I may not be all that you want me to be, but thank God today, he is still working on me. God is looking for some revivalists in Johnson Park Church. I wonder if you want to enlist yourself today as one of those revivalists who need to know that Jesus forgave you over and over in the past, and he will forgive you over and over again. Somebody needs to say, yes, he did. Somebody needs to say, I just want to thank God for saving me. I just want to thank God for never giving up on me. I want to thank God for looking past my yesterday. I want to thank God for setting me free. I want to thank God for planting my feet on higher ground. I want to thank him forever and ever. Thank you, Jesus, for allowing me to see you high and lifted up. Thank you, Jesus, for never giving up on me. Thank you, Jesus, for being my bread when I was hungry. Thank you, Jesus, for being my bridge over my troubled water. Thank you, Jesus, for being my doctor in my sick room. Thank you, Jesus, for being my all and in all. But the text that was read ended by saying that when Isaiah saw the Lord, looked at himself, he cried out and said, woe is me. I am a man of unclean lips. I am a sinner. Then the Bible said when he cried out, the Lord sent an angel with a live coal from the altar, placed it between his lips, and then his sins were purged and he was forgiven. Then the Bible tells us that Isaiah said, woe is me. Then God asked him the question, whom can I send to? Who will go for me today? Oh, the question is asking to somebody in line, somebody from Johnson Park SDA Church right now, whom shall I send? Because when you see the Lord, when you see him sitting on his throne, in control, high and lifted up, because he's about to lift you up, and his strength fill the temple. When you see all of that, you will say, woe is me, and you will say, here am I, send me. Is there someone today online listening who want to say, Lord, send me? I am worthy, I am unworthy, but you can use anything, Lord. You can use me. Johnson Park, those online, you need to see the Lord for yourself. My daughter is getting ready now to sing for us. And as she sings this morning, please, please, as she sings to us today, please, just remember that seeing the Lord is important. Don't look at anybody else. Look to Jesus. I hope you let her in right now. She's somewhere getting ready to come online right now. And she's going to sing for us today. Johnson Park Church, look to Jesus. He's the author and finish off your faith. He's coming soon. Do you believe that? He is coming soon. Danelia, if you can hear me, if you can't get on, come on down and take my microphone and sing from it if you can't. But I'm sure she's somewhere trying to come in right now. Just bring her in for me as she sing for us, because somebody today need to know who God is and where he lives. He's the lily of the valley. He's a brighter morning star. He is our everything. Go with God, knowing
that he will carry you through. Go ahead, my child, and sing.
God provides, so why do I worry about my life when you've come to my rescue a thousand times? Every other voice, it is a lie. God provides in ways I can't explain and can't deny. The little that I have, he multiplies. And when I feel he won't show up on time, God provides, he'll come through. When the clouds of doubt rain down on you and test everything you thought you knew, see how you finally see what God can do for you. So tonight, close your eyes, there's no more need to fight. Watch God provide. God provides. It's hard to say when there's no food to eat, or what you see fills all that life will be. And will this be another year of misery for me? But my faith can survive on just things I see, and my feelings can control my destiny. See, God, I only want what you believe for me. So today, close your eyes, there's no more need to fight. Watch God provide. He will provide right before your eyes. Oh, he will. So tonight, close your eyes, there's no more need.
Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you. We bless you for who you are. You are our friend and our Savior. Right now, we are letting go. And God, you know, we know you will provide. Whatever the challenges are, whatever the struggles are, it may be mourning, it may be a tragedy, it may be the loss of your job, it may be sickness. Whatever you're going through, watch God provide, because he will. Yes, he will. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Thank you
for speaking to our hearts today. Thank you for reminding us that you're still sitting on your throne, high and lifted up. Thank you, Lord, for reminding us that whatever we are going through, we must keep our eyes on Jesus, because very soon and very soon he will come and will take us safely home, where all of these things will be over. Until then, keep your people faithful. In the worthy name of Jesus Christ, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord lift up the countenance of his face upon you. The Lord grant you his peace. Peace in your homes, peace in your church, peace in your hearts, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. What a word. What a word. Hallelujah. The word was filled with energy and spirit. Thank you, God. Thank you, Pastor Frey. And thank you, Danilia, for that beautiful song. Haven't we been blessed today, church? I have been. God is good, and he continues to bless us with his words. I want to thank you, Pastor, for taking the time to put the word together and to share it with us. As you continue to minister, I pray that the Lord will bless your ministry and that he will prosper it. May we all have a spirit-filled and a blessed day today, and may we move on not being the same after we would have heard this sermon, is my prayer for you all in Jesus' name. I think we'll have the benediction.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are ever grateful to you for your blessings towards us. Thank you for this message we would have received today. Pray, God, that as we leave our virtual church setting here, that we will never leave your presence, that we will take this word with us, that we will go knowing that in every circumstance we can say, but God, thank you again, O Lord, for all you've done for us and will continue to do. In Jesus' name we pray.
Just
All right, I think at this time we're going to be opening up the mics for you to greet each other. Is that right, Barry?
Yeah, we just want to stop the stream first with the banner.
Okay.